Okay, hello everyone. Let's start eventually our lecture. By the way, imagine or not, it's day 20 today. We almost passed half semester and we're in good shape, I believe. I recall homework 4 is due today. And in fact, after this, homework 5 will be posted. I hope by this weekend, maybe earlier, even today, if we manage it. And we're in good shape. So last time we started talking about chapter 5, right? And we will continue this today. So basically what it is about, I recall what we're talking about. So we talk about open system, correct? So, and what you see on your screen, these are will be the basic equations which describe this system. So you should remember equation for mass flow rate. Everybody remember this? And equation for mass balance, and below in the red frame, it's energy balance. So, but please realize the following. This equation, it's not like for open system just. This is a general form of equations. This is a general form of mass conservation, right? And energy conservation. So that it is. That's how they look like. And it's very easy to go back from here to closed system. So what should we do to go to closed system? What do we know about closed system? For closed system, mass is fixed. So what will happen with all our equation if mass is fixed? Simply, m dot will be zero. M dot will be zero. All these will be zeros. So because for closed system, our equation look like m is constant, correct? So no reason to talk about these equations. But for equation below, again, what happened if mass is constant? You don't have these terms, right? And we come back to this, chapter 4, chapter 2. So what we see in general, is this actually generalized form of equation or of balance equation? But of course, in general case, these terms, which are related to mass flow, they actually dominate. Okay, they actually dominate. They actually dominate over just energy balance. Now, I told you that luckily, so basically when you start solving any problem in chapter 5, you should start with writing down what I did here and then see how to apply it. And real life application, very often, most likely, I like this, turbines, compressors, nozzles, diffusers, whatever we discussed last time, we also will be talking about throttling valve, about heat exchanger, about mixers, many other things. Say like this. And then you will read the text body and see, luckily, you should not solve all this big equation all the time. Very often you will have some simplification. For instance, very often, like I already told you, if there is no mass flow, you come back to chapter 4. But even if this term exists, very often it will be stated like you have adiabatic or insulated turbine, for instance. What does it mean, adiabatic or insulated? It will mean that you don't have this term, right? Or it may be stated that you have horizontal IT system. What does it mean horizontal? Then change of potential energy may be neglected. Or it may be even stated that please neglect the change in kinetic and potential energy. And I will show you that for turbines is typically all the case. Today we'll talk about this. We'll have example of this. Correct? Or it may be stated that, well, it may be stated that there is no work done, then you don't have this torque. And more often, very often, you will have what we call steady system. For steady system, you don't have these terms, right? Now, at this point, I want you to show some difference we discussed last time, but I recall there is some conceptual difference here between closed and open system. So let's recall what we did. Let's recall what we did in chapter 4. Let's say in chapter 4, it was like this. You had like closed system. Let's say you have piston cylinder assembly like this. So that, let's say it was state 1, for instance. And then it was stated that you cool your system or you do something with your system. And eventually it becomes like this, right? From state 1 to state 2. That what your state 1, state 2, and your trajectory between them. It may be like this. It can be vice versa, but that's what we did. First it was state one, and then you have state two. Now, please realize that for open system, this is not the case. What is the case? Now, here is, let's say here is your system. Okay, here is your system. Here is you have inlet, and here is you have outlet. This is state one, and this is state two. So do you understand now what we're talking about? Now, in your, let's consider you are a bird or a fish or insect which comes into some kind of boiler or turbine or whatever. And here inside the turbine, you are baked, shaked, compressed, cooked, and whatever, and then you go out. So this is, so your state one, it's your injection position, it's your inlet, and state two is your outlet. Okay. Or let's say is you have a river, Monongahela River, and you travel from Morgantown to Pittsburgh. Okay. So then please understand that Morgantown and Pittsburgh, they coexist. They exist simultaneously, right? But for traveler, you are first in Morgantown and then tomorrow you will be in Pittsburgh if you travel through the river, if you are a fish which travels. But when this traveler will be here, another fish will come here. So that it is. So please understand the following, that what we have talked about, state one is inlet and state two is outlet. Now, what does it mean that your system is steady? Steady means you don't have these storms. So steady means that your entire system is uniform in time, but not in space. Steady, for our example, means the following. That, of course, Morgantown is always different from Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh is a big city, Morgantown is a town with different population and so on. But steady means that Morgantown today, tomorrow, and in 20 years, it will be the same Morgantown. And Pittsburgh, it will be the same Pittsburgh. And the fish traveling from Morgantown to Pittsburgh will do exactly the same travel all the time. That is steady. Even in space, they change. Unsteady would mean that tomorrow in Morgantown, it will be million new inhabitants, which will convert it into tremendous big megapolis. That is unsteady. Unsteady means that your state one and state two change. Steady means that one and two don't change, but they're still different. Of course, state one and state two are always different because otherwise there is no reason to have this device. That's something I want you to remember. Any question at this point, please? So that's what we did. And that's what we discussed last time. And in fact, we even start talking about examples. Right, and we consider what happened if you have steady system, and we talk about some examples. Remember, we talk about nozzles and diffusers. And I recall, so what I say, what are nozzles and diffusers? So basically nozzles and diffusers, these are devices, very simple devices, which convert actually kinetic energy into enthalpy or say velocity into pressure or vice versa. It's very simple. Like, you know, if you drive on highway, you practically, if you go with free on free highway with no traffic, typically you are free, you don't interact with other cars, right? But when traffic starts, you slow down because you don't want to hit somebody. And so you start interacting with other cars. It will be tension there, right? Tension between you. So what happens actually is that you convert your velocity into your pressure. So, and basically, that's equations that you see here. It will be your basic equation for nozzles and diffusers. So basically enthalpy plus specific enthalpy plus specific kinetic energy is fixed. So if you consider nozzle and diffuser, what typically terms that you can neglect? Definitely you want to neglect your work, nothing expands or compress. Definitely if it's horizontal nozzle, there will be no this term. So what you will have, if you wanted to have adiabatic, you don't want to have heat losses. So that will be the case that enthalpy is related to kinetic energy, right? Any question about this? Now, there is some tricky things that I want you to understand. It's not very straightforward. So when you can neglect these terms and when you cannot. So correct answer is the following. If you have data for these items, if you have data for Q, for Z, you should account for it. Okay? If you don't have the data, sometimes you may neglect depending on what you have. Like you may neglect it work output for nozzle, but definitely will not neglect it for a turbine. And today we'll discuss more about that. So that's what it is. And there is one more thing that I want you to show. Look here on this balance equation. So what are the units and dimensions? Your units and dimensions should be self-consistent. If you go to the table, you will realize that your enthalpy is measured in kilojoules per kilogram, right? But if you talk about velocity, what is velocity? It's meters per second. So this value here, it will be meter squared over second squared, which is joule per kilogram. And it's not kilojoule per kilogram. Remember, kilojoule per kilogram, it's 1,000 times larger. It's important to remember. You may not imagine how many of you, or better those who don't attend my lectures, will do this mistake in your exam two. By the way, I recall your exam two just 2 weeks from now. Quite close. So please understand. And how to avoid this mistake all the time? Very simple idea. Write down dimensions all the time. You will not confuse. I will show now example and you will see how it's important. It's very good example. This is actually example from your textbook. It's example number 5.4. So what do you have here? Do you see my screen? I believe so. Let's read this text and I will show why it's a very illustrative example. I will tell you because it's exactly we discussed here what can be neglected and what cannot. So what you have? You have diffuser with air. So this is your air, okay? It's your diffusers. So here is your inlet, here is your outlet. And your inlet condition is the following. So your inlet cross area is given. This is A1, okay? And it's stated that your A1 is here. Here it is, 0.4 meters squared is given. And you also know other conditions here. You know initial velocity, you know V1, which is 200 meters per second. And you know initial temperature and pressure. You have T1, V1 is 200 meters per second. And T1 is 10 degrees Celsius. And don't forget to convert it into Kelvin if needed. It should be 283 Kelvin. And you have P1 is what? 80 kilopascals. 80 kilopascals, okay? So that you have at the very beginning. And what you have at the exit? You don't know nothing about your exit, but it's stated that velocity at the exit is smallest compared to initial one. So you see you have that V2 is much less than V1, okay? You have this. So generally speaking, you will neglect V2. You can forget about it. And basically the question is, please find mass flow rate and temperature at state two. And T2. So how to solve this problem? Key point is the following. You should remember the following. You should understand that mass is balanced. So if you go back to what? If you go back to our equations, you may see what happened with our classical equation here. Here is our basic equation, what you neglect. So all these big terms will disappear. And you will end up only in this equation. And what do you see in this equation? In this equation, you will see that M1 is equal to M2. So you can get rid of them. And then you coupled H and V. Why do I say this? Because in fact, you will realize now that what? You will realize now then what? Then M.2 is the same. So M2. Is equal to M1. and you can find it. How can you find it? Quite simple. So what is the formula for m dot? Here is your formula. It will be velocity over this, right? Where is this formula for us? Here you can see that in our case, here is a formula, right? Here is a formula. So you have A, you have V. Do you know initial A? Yes, you have. Do you know initial V? Yes, you have. How to find specific volume? Well, for this, you may have, you have ideal gas law, right? So you write down ideal gas law that P1 V1 is RT1. Here you can see it here. So basically that what is you are getting and you calculate. So if you substitute, you will find initial specific volume in the inlet. Pay attention, here temperature is in Kelvin. Don't substitute 10 degrees here. You should convert into Kelvin. Do you see it? This is from the table and this is 80 kilopascals here. So that's what you calculate and you will find that V1 is this value. And then what? And then you substitute everything into m dot value and you will calculate it. So that's important. And then you calculate, it will be about 79 kilograms per second. So that's first equation. Now question, what is the temperature at the outlet? And of course, then you should employ second equation. And how this equation will be in our case? In our case, it's steady system. You don't have this, you don't have this, you don't have this. So you will have these relations, correct? So you will have this. So that's your equation. And from here, you calculate that H2 is equal to H1 minus V1 squared over 2. Please see the screen how it calculated. Later when you neglect all this term and when you have time, you can do it in monitors. Do you understand this? Do you have any questions? But now I encourage you, so basically, and I recall, you know that V2 is much less than V1. So generally speaking, you will get rid of V2 terms and have just V1 here. You don't have this, but otherwise you may account for it. Now, I encourage you to look again. So where to get H1? From the table. You have initial condition. So what table will you consider? It's very simple. What table will you consider? You will go to table for air. It's table A17, correct? And in this table, you see what you have temperature and what you calculate. Go to temperature A17. Why I show you to this? I want to show one trick now. Please pay attention. Please wake up if you sleep. If you don't sleep, wake up anyway. Now, so this is table A17. What do we have in table A17? So here you have temperature and enthalpy versus it, right? So what, where we go? Where we go here? We go to temperature of so what's our temperature? It's 10 degrees Celsius, which is what? It's 283 Kelvin. So generally speaking, you should interpolate between this and this to get your value for entropy. And that's what people did. And if you look at the screen here, where is it? Yeah, that's how they calculated. They actually calculated that H1 is like this and this value. Now, pay attention to this value in Kelvin and this value in kilojoule per kilogram. I give you a nice hint. Remember that H is actually Cp over T, right? And for air, this value is 1 or 5 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin. Nice? So what does it, it just coincided just because of it, it happens like this. So what does it mean? It means that with accuracy of 0.5%, you know what you can do. With accuracy of 0.5%, let's go to the table again. And you will see that with accuracy of 0.5%, enthalpy in kilojoule per kilogram is equivalent to temperature in Kelvin. See tap 250, 250 over 5, 270, 270, 11, 300, 309. Well, for big values, it's star deviation something, but still it's quite close. So basically this is for air and that is very lucky result. The temperature in Kelvin corresponds to enthalpy in kilojoule per kilogram. It's really save your time if you just without interpolation can estimate it like this. Do you understand? Any question? Great. Then go back to our, what we have here. Even so, we find H1 And then what? I take this H1 and I substitute it here. But now please pay attention what is going on. I will have that H2 will be 283 kilojoule per kilogram. And I substitute velocity zero because V2 is zero. Now I have 200 meters over second squared in two. And then look please here. You know what's going on here? Why we divide by 1,000? Because 200 meters over second in squared, it will give what? It will be 40,000. Or what? 40,000 over 2. Or what? Joule per kilogram. And if you want to go to kilojoule, you get rid of three order, please. It's important to calculate. So in fact, you have here in terms only 20 kilojoule per kilogram. Not 20,000, but 20. So what is nice to see? So H1 was 283. Velocity term give you, kinetic energy term give you 20, and altogether you come to 3/3. Please understand. Not 20,000 something, but 300/3. This is 20 kilojoule per kilogram. I recall short time because believe me, those who don't take my lectures, 20% of you will do this mistake at your exam. And you know why you will do this mistake? Or those will do it? Because you don't write dimensions. You will write 283 plus 20,000 and we will come to 20,283. And we got ridiculously big number. In reality, number is not big, it's like this. And then, okay, again, you may understand that this value corresponds to what? To about 33 Kelvin, which is about 30 degrees Celsius. So I want you to pay attention to something here. So your velocity in this nozzle is quite big. It's 200 meters per second. You know what is it? What is sound speed? Sound speed is 313 meters per second. So it's very big speed. It's not, it's near sonic. It's actually passenger flight, like passenger Boeing, which flies like inside the country, they fly with this speed. It's very fast. It's very fast. 200 meters per second, it's very big value. But all this big value, 200 meters per second, all this kinetic energy, when it's converted into enthalpy, you change your enthalpy only by what? By 20 out of 283, but by about how much? About like 7%, right? 7%, it's not a big value. And your temperature change only by, well, if you talk about Celsius, your temperature goes from 10 Celsius to 30 Celsius, but in terms of Kelvin, it's not a big change. Please understand this. That is why we use steam machine. That is why I tell you, it's a huge, huge energy which is stored in enthalpy. That's why instead of using elephants, camels, donkeys, horses, slaves, whatever it is, people use steam. Big, big energy stored there. The flow with a speed of 200 meters per second, imagine how big it is, how windy would it be. Typical wind is like 10 meters per second, 20 meters per second, 10 times more. All this wind generates only 7% of enthalpy. And imagine if you can take all this enthalpy and convert it into kinetic energy. The flow will be hypersonic. It's very big energy there. Don't forget about this three orders of magnitude. Do you understand this, please? Any question? Please ask me something if you have questions. Okay. I assume, and in your homework, you may, I hope it will be posted soon. In your homework file, you will definitely have something like this. So I believe at this point, you know how to operate with nozzles and diffusers. But there's this simplest devices. Let's now talk about more complex, like turbines, compressor fans, when really you talk about work input and what output. What happens for compressors? Actually, for compressors, something comes in and goes out and you deposit work input here to generate a compressor. You deposit it and something will be happening. You know what is the difference between pump and compressor? In fact, generally speaking, pumps operate with liquids and compressor operates with gases. And turbines is like anti-compressor. So what happened in turbine, like this is a classical example of a turbine. So you have huge flow, like sometimes it's supersonic flow. Flow comes there and inside of this device like this, and in this device you have blades. So when flow comes, it rotates the blade and this blade generates work output. That's how turbine works. So in fact, turbines, it's one of the major devices we deal in thermodynamics. Because that's how power plants work. For instance, you may have water power plant. When water falls down, rotate turbine rotate generator, and generate electricity. So what happens here? How to describe turbine? So what do you want from your turbine? Again, you want your turbine to be steady. So you don't have energy to. And remember, if you have steady device, in this equation, there is no energy term. It's only enthalpy term, specific enthalpy here. So that's why I told you that chapter 5 is about enthalpy. Open system about enthalpy. Even the enthalpy does not exist in reality, it's enthalpy generation. Enthalpy rather than something else. It's enthalpy generation, correct? So what is it? What we have here? If what you would like from your turbine at least, you don't want to have kinetic energy because it will be lost something. You don't want to have elevation typically. You don't want to have heat losses. So then if you neglect this term, this will be equation for your turbine. Again, at next 5 minutes, I will tell you why we neglect these terms. But now please believe me and you will see that what is the basic idea about turbine. So turbine converts enthalpy into work. And then let me ask you, is this, if you look at this equation that I see downstairs here, is it positive or negative? Who thinks positive, who thinks negative? In fact, you agree that I can write it like this. H1 dot minus O. When H1 is nothing like M dot H1, and here I have minus right? So, is it positive or negative? What do you think? Well, people say negative. Why do you think negative? In fact, to understand it, you should, so what turbine does and how it look like? Let me say like this. So what is a turbine? Some flow goes in and produces. Why do we need turbine? You need turbine to produce work. So basically it's like this. You had some level of enthalpy. You spent it. And then you drop to another level of enthalpy. And what you spent here was converted into work out, which is H1 minus H2. And which is positive. Positive. This should be positive because please understand what's going on. Like you have some money in your pocket, but you don't want to clean your room or you don't want to put heavy loading upstairs. So you pay money somebody who will do it for you, put your loading upstairs, right? And you will have less money eventually. So that's what you do in a turbine. You spend enthalpy to produce work. And then this work will go and you can be utilized usefully in electrical setup, in whatever to generate electricity. So what is power plant? What is electrical power plant? Let's say you have waterfall and at the outcome you have electricity. So you spend enthalpy of this waterfall to generate electricity. You pay enthalpy. Not entirely, you cannot spend entire enthalpy, something remains. And the rest of enthalpy, the difference in enthalpy generates your positive work output. Does it make sense for you? So this is positive. Because when we'll talk about compressor, it will be vice versa. And now I will show you why actually we may neglect this term and this term. So let's assume we don't neglect. Let's assume we should account for all the terms. And then let us evaluate how big they are. Okay, so for this purpose, and later you can do it yourself again, I do recommend that you go to example 5.7. It's a nice example about steam turbine. 5.7 is turbine. So you see it on my screen. So what happened here? You have actually some kind of steam turbine here, and it is stated what? It is stated here that in the inlet, you have the following condition. In the inlet, you have this is your initial pressure is 2 megapascals. Initial temperature is 400 degrees Celsius. Initial velocity is 50 meters per second. Initial elevation is 10 meters. At the outlet, you have pressure to be 15 kilopascals. Here is your quality. So from since you know the quality, you already know that it will be saturated mixture, right? And here you have your velocity and it. So you have state one. Also, it stated that work output here is given. But the question is, what will be work output per unit mass? And mass flow rate, in that case, can be found here as well. So what we are going to do? Since you have V1 and Z1, V2 and Z2, you should count for them. So it's not like you neglect them. Now you should count for them. So basically, if you look here now, this term and this term that will exist. And let's calculate. So what you can do from here? You know P1 and T1. Is it enough to identify state one? Yes, like always you will do. You will say, assume this is saturated mixture. And then you will see that it's not saturated. You will see it's superheated. And then you will see that you should go to table A6 and you will get the correct answer. Here it is. So for this value, you will have that correct value is here. You will have that H1 is given something like 3248. 3248.4. Kilojoule per kilogram, of course. Write down dimensions. So the same for state two. What do you have for state two? You have this pressure and specific and quality. So you will have that what? That H2 will be what? Will be HF plus X2 HFG at this parameters. That's how it will be. Here it is. So basically, that's how you calculate. So this will be state one, and this will be for state two, okay? Great. Now, what to do then? What to do? Now, you also have velocities and you have other terms. So let me calculate what you may have. So what will be your formula in general case? So you will have that this is your total equation. You agree? This will be your total equation. And if you divide both sides by mass, you will have what? That your, like you may calculate it from here. If you calculate from here, here will be work output will be m dot this minus this. Here it is. So basically, you will have that your work output. Okay, I talk about the value per unit mass. It will be what? It will be delta H plus change in kinetic energy plus change in Z, like delta H, delta KE, delta PE. But what I want you to, let's calculate all these values. And if you calculate all these values, you will see the following. The delta H, it will be what? It will be 888 kilojoule per kilogram. Well, here is sign minus, but here it will come to plus. Kinetic energy, if you calculate it, it looks like it may give you a tremendous number. V squared over 2 minus V1 squared over 2. It looks like it's a very big number, but it's not a big number, right? Because you divide it by 1000. You arrived only to 15 kilojoule per kilogram. And if you talk about delta Z, it's again, it will be quite small number. It will be just only 0.04 if in kilojoule per kilogram. So please calculate. This is contribution of enthalpy. This is contribution of internal energy, of kinetic energy. And this is contribution of height. So that it is 888 here and 872 together. What does it mean? It means that generally you might neglect these terms. You might. The change is what? It was like 18 over 800. It's like a couple of percent. It's only a couple of percent error here. So you might definitely neglect them. You might. Sorry, I don't know why I jumped here. Why I jumped here. Any question at this point? And do you understand now what we did? I recall now. Sorry for delay with the screen. I will recall it now. Yes. Here is the power generator. So that's what we do. So please, you may realize from here that enthalpy is definitely dominate over the other terms. If you look here, you will see this is delta H, this is delta kinetic, that's delta potential. And that's how it is. Why we got it like this? Very simple. Because you should not forget about one key item. You should not forget divide by 1000, divide by 1000 here. Don't forget it. Always write that dimension. And you will realize here that if you do vice versa, if you forget about the 1000, you will get to something ridiculous number. Instead of 15, you will have minus 15,000. So your result will be negative, which is impossible. In reality, these results are small. It is huge, huge energy, which is stored with enthalpy. You see, that is enthalpy change. And this is just kinetic and potential energy. You must remember this. That's why. If you talk about turbine, then what, like we discussed here, you can, generally speaking, neglect this term. Again, you can neglect if there are no data for this. If there are data, you cannot, right? And you discussed that it's larger than zero. Any question about a turbine? So let's talk about anti-turbine that we call compressor. So what do we know about compressor and pumps? As we discussed, that compressor is device which gets work from electrical supply or whatever to increase pressure of the air. So basically, what will be equation for compressor? So again, what do you want from compressor? You don't want kinetic energy to change. You don't want to have elevation or dropping. You don't want to have heat losses. So if you're right, you will come to this value. And let me ask you something now. Let me ask you, did you ever see this formula before? Yes or not? Did you see this formula before? Where did you see this formula? I think you saw this formula when we discussed what? When we discussed turbines. So does it mean that turbines are identical to compressors? No, they are vice versa. Why? Because what compressor does? In fact, and let me ask you, this value for compressor, will it be positive or negative? Will it be positive or negative? This value will be negative. I can write it actually, exactly like before. I can write it like this. But this value will be negative because what compressor does? In fact, compressor takes, so it's vice versa. Imagine you have H1 here. And then you deposit electrical work from outside, work input. And then you have H2. That's why this value is negative. It's negative. It's like, let's see. For turbine, I remember what I told you. You have money in your pocket. Your money, your currency is enthalpy. You have your money in your pocket. So you spend money and turbine does work for you. It gets this money. For compressor, it's vice versa. You work. You compress your air, you take electricity from the street and deposit it inside such that your enthalpy grows, right? Now you earn money. Somebody pay it to you and it goes up. So definitely at the end of a turbine, you have less enthalpy because you spend enthalpy to produce work. in the end of compressor, you have high enthalpy because you worked and somebody paid you. You were paid and your money came to you. So formula is exactly the same, but the signs are different. Do you understand this? Exactly, very good comment. Work is negative when it's done on the system. Yes? What does compressor? Compressor produces work on your air. Yes? That's why it's negative. Compressor compresses air. Your system is your air. Compressor produces work on your air. While for turbine, it's vice versa. It is air or steam that produces work, right? So in the case of turbine, work is done by the system. Your fluid goes in the turbine and rotate blades, right? What we have in turbine. That's actually a good point that you mentioned. Let's discuss it. So again, I let's waste a little bit of time, but realize. So what turbine does? Here, there are blades. There is a flow. Flow rotates the blade and produces work. So work is done by the system and somebody will use it later. For instance, you will rotate generator and get electricity. So the work will be positive. In compressors, like here, at the end, your pressure is higher than here. So this work is taken from electrical power supply and is done on the system. That's why it is negative. Any more questions? Please understand the difference. Yeah, one more question here. Yeah, where is M dot in the example that I resolved? I will show you, okay. Here it is. The question here is we should calculate work output per unit mass. So we take work output and divide by M dot. That's very often we deal in our setups. Remember, I tell you, no reason to talk about mass of the river. There is a question about rates. So we talk about work output per kilogram, which is W dot, work output per second, which is work output here, or per mass. When you divide work output over M dot, it will be canceled. So this is a small value. It's capital work out divided by M dot. Do you understand this? Otherwise, let me write like this. So I can write that work output is equal to M dot, and here I will have I will have H1 plus V1 squared over 2 plus G Z1 minus H2 minus V2 squared over 2 minus G Z2. Here it is. Do I understand? And work small out, it's nothing but work capital out divided by M dot, which gives just this value that you have here. Do you understand this? Any more question, please? So that it is. So that's what makes difference between turbine and compressor. Okay. For instance, yes, in your homework, you may have example, a similar example about a turbine to what we consider. And there is a nice example about compressor. So also, I would recommend you to go through it and consider. For instance, there is example 5.6 that you see on the screen. It stated that air comes here. It comes here. So yeah, let's see, you have air compressor. And basically, the setup is very similar to what you have here on the screen. So what is happening here? It stated that you have pressure at 100 kilopascals and initial temperature is 280 Kelvin. It comes here in the compressor. And the mass flow rate is 0.02 kilogram per second. It stated that at the outlet you have P2 is 600 kilopascals and T2 is 400 Kelvin. And also you have heat losses here per kilogram. So it's 16 kilogram, kilojoule per kilogram. And that's definitely, this is negative value because it goes out of the system. And we will be talking about work input here. Right? So basically that's what you will have, right? It's exactly the point. So what we will write? You have state one, you have state two, right? So for state two, you can find whatever you need for state one. From here, you will have H2. From here, you will have H1. And then you can write your balance equation. You will have like this. You will have this consideration. Definitely, again, you can go to a table and you will find that H1 will correspond to something that to 80 Kelvin, H2 will correspond to 400 Kelvin, and you can actually approximate it like back to 80 and 400 kilojoule per kilogram. And then work output, it will given by this equation, right? Well, if you write like this, it will be positive, but if you write like in my formulation, like I did it here, it will definitely be, if you just calculate as I wrote it here, definitely the value will be negative for compressor. Okay, people ask about homework. Homework 5 is not posted yet because I'm still waiting for homework 4 to submit. I know sometimes when they are both posted, people start confusing and submit them in wrong hole. But I do believe that we should post it this weekend. I will prepare it and Dr. Hedrick should approve it. And yeah, it's good to start working on it because we almost did half of chapter 5. I believe at this point we went through nozzles, turbines, nozzles, diffusers, turbines, compressors, what else? There is still, we'll talk still about other devices on, we talk about throttling valve, mixers and heat exchangers, and that's practically all. So I believe on Monday and Wednesday, we are ready to complete chapter 5. And I still think we need to, well, maybe to, we may have spent one day to give you one more optional quiz, I believe it. Good question about exam. Yes, yeah, we are a little bit ahead of schedule. That's a good point. But I think I still in 2 weeks from now. I think because if we start changing, it will be bad habits. So yes, I plan exam in 2 weeks from now. But I may give you one more optional quiz between them, such that one lecture will be devoted to optional quiz. And if possible, well, it would be great if you can start chapter 6 earlier. I will also try to do it. But otherwise, yes, your exam is in 2 weeks from now. Your homework 5 will be due Wednesday in March 24. But I want to post it soon. Okay, and I think at this point, I can stop this lecture. Do you have any particular question now? Okay. So I will stop recording at this point, but I will stop recording, yes. I will be able in my office now, hours now, and please come if you need, right? Thank you. Thank you. By some reason, it does not allow me to, okay, I should share screen again, I believe, right? To stop recording. Okay, stop sharing. Okay. Okay. Good luck. Okay, stop.